This video is sponsored by Magellan TV. Dark matter is everywhere in the universe, acting like an invisible glue that binds galaxies together. Without it, galaxies wouldn't have formed, and we wouldn't be here to wonder what dark matter is. Clusters of galaxies dominated by dark matter act as strong gravitational lenses, bending the light of the background galaxies into multiple images and arcs of light. Astronomers can use these clusters as natural laboratories to test theoretical models of dark matter. But new observations by the Hubble Space Telescope show that some concentrations of dark matter produce lensing effects that are 10 times more frequent and even stronger than predicted. This new discovery is more than just a little surprising. It could very well signal a gap in astronomers' current understanding of the very nature of dark matter. Welcome back to Launchpad. I'm Christian Reddy, your friendly neighborhood astronomer. For over a century, the universe has presented us with a particularly nagging problem. It has much more mass than we can see. Something like 85% of the matter in the universe is in the form of dark matter, yet we have no way of directly imaging it. Instead, we can only infer its existence by the gravity it exerts on normal matter, such as galaxies. In fact, our own Milky Way has a mass of 1.5 trillion suns, even though it consists of only about 100 billion suns. The rest is mostly dark matter. We'll talk more about how we came to understand that dark matter is a thing and why these new results pose a challenge to our current understanding of it. But first, I'd like to thank Magellan TV, who are very kindly sponsoring today's video. Magellan is a new documentary streaming service that dives deep into topics such as history, art, nature, and of course, my favorites, space and science. In fact, while researching this video, I watched The Mystery of Dark Matter, directed by Cécile Dengene. This documentary describes the efforts between astrophysicists, cosmologists, and particle physicists to understand and directly detect dark matter in particle accelerators. New programs are added weekly and can be watched on Roku, Amazon Fire TV, Apple TV, Google Play, and iOS. If you enjoy the content here on Launchpad Astronomy, then I think you'll enjoy Magellan TV. That's why I'm delighted to tell you about a special offer just for my viewers. By signing up at the link below, you'll get an extra month of Magellan TV absolutely free. Please make sure to use the link in the description of this video. The idea of unseen matter in galaxy clusters was first raised in 1933, when Fritz Zwicky measured the velocities of the Coma cluster of galaxies. He found that the galaxies, especially those at the cluster's edges, were moving so fast the cluster needed about 400 times the mass of its own galaxies to hold itself together. Zwicky's estimates were off by a factor of 10 because he derived his estimate from Edwin Hubble's measurement of the expansion rate of the universe, which itself wasn't very accurate. But still, Zwicky was ultimately on the right track. In the 1960s and 70s, Vera Rubin measured the rotation rates of several edge-on spiral galaxies, including the Andromeda Galaxy, our closest spiral neighbor. Spiral galaxies are essentially giant disks of stars and gas, most of which are concentrated at the center with fewer out along the edges. So, if we were to plot the rotational velocity of the disk with increasing distance from its center, we'd expect the velocity to fall off with distance, just like the planets do in the solar system. But if anything, Rubin confirmed what others had noticed before, that the rotation curves of spiral galaxies were generally flat. In other words, their outer disks rotate at least as fast, and in many cases even faster, than their central regions. It soon became widely accepted that galaxies must be suspended in halos of dark matter that give the galaxies and clusters the necessary mass to hold themselves together. As its name implies, dark matter doesn't reveal itself at any wavelength, whether it's radio, infrared, ultraviolet, or X-ray. There's simply far too little luminous matter to account for the mass that's out there. Whatever dark matter is, it's a very different thing from the stuff that makes up everything from you and me to the stars and galaxies. We can only detect it via its gravity. Fortunately, galaxy clusters give us an ideal laboratory to probe and study dark matter. Their gravity bends and magnifies the light from distant background galaxies in an effect called gravitational lensing. If the background source and the foreground lensing object are both compact enough, the lens can generate up to 4 images of the background object in what's called an Einstein cross. And if the alignment between the background object and lens is almost exactly perfect, light will pass around all sides of the lensing object and produce an Einstein ring. But clusters of galaxies are extended and clumpy by their nature. So instead of crosses or rings, they produce arcs and multiple smeared images of background galaxies. That's actually a good thing because it allows astronomers to use these arcs to map out the distribution of dark matter within the cluster. Over the last decade, astronomers have been using the Hubble Space Telescope to look at a lot of galaxy clusters in 2 key surveys. The Cluster Lensing and Supernova Survey with Hubble, or CLASH, devoted 525 of Hubble's orbits to studying 25 different galaxy clusters from 2010 to 2013. This was followed by an even deeper survey called the Hubble Frontier Fields. HFF devoted even more time, 560 Hubble orbits, to examine just 6 galaxy clusters from 2013 to 2017. These long observing campaigns produced the deepest, most precise images of gravitational lenses ever attempted. This data set allows astronomers to test their models of dark matter. To that end, a team of astronomers led by Massimo Meneghetti used 11 different galaxy clusters from the 2 surveys to map out the dark matter from their gravitational lenses. By their nature, galaxy clusters are a combination of smaller, concentrated objects, in this case the individual galaxies, and the larger scale structure that makes up the overall cluster. If the individual galaxies are small and compact enough, they'll produce some of the strongest lensing effects. For example, in the cluster MAX-J1206, a background galaxy is lensed by a compact cluster galaxy into an Einstein ring. Another galaxy is lensed into an Einstein cross, and a third galaxy is lensed into multiple images of itself. To figure out how the dark matter needs to behave, Meneghetti and his team built computer models of clusters with similar masses, distances, shapes, and member galaxies. Then they let the light from background galaxies pass through them to see how often they made lenses. To their surprise, the computer models only made about a tenth of the number of lenses observed. Put another way, real clusters made 10 times the number of lenses predicted. A factor of 10 difference is huge, and not something that can be easily explained. So the team tried to resolve the discrepancy by testing different properties of their model. For example, galaxies typically have supermassive black holes at their centers. These black holes accrete matter from the surrounding galaxy and produce energy in the process. But that same energy pushes outward on the surrounding galaxy, so the galaxy is puffier and less centrally concentrated. By turning off the black hole accretion in their model, the team found that the galaxies in their virtual clusters did become more compact and turn into stronger gravitational lenses. But it wasn't nearly enough to bridge the gap between the observations and the simulations. Besides, not having central black holes accreting doesn't really make sense in the first place because the clusters are being seen at a time when central black hole accretion was a fairly common thing in the universe. The team also tested whether dark matter halos from galaxies in front of the cluster could somehow amplify the small lensing effects. They didn't. No matter what they tried, none of the tricks worked. Real clusters produced far more frequent and, in many cases, stronger gravitational lenses than our current understanding of dark matter predicts. This implies that the galaxies in these clusters have dark matter halos that are somehow more compact than theoretically expected. Now, I'll note that in their paper, the researchers don't go so far as to say there's a missing ingredient in dark matter or that there has to be some new weird physics going on. Rather, they're just pointing out the discrepancy between the frequency of gravitational lenses in the cluster galaxies versus the simulations. It remains to be seen what's actually missing from the simulations, but an order of magnitude difference is a really interesting result that demands attention. So, what could be going on? Well, clearly these dark matter halos appear to be denser than previously thought. Maybe that's because dark matter interacts with normal matter differently than we think and compresses the halos in the process. Or maybe the very physics of dark matter is somehow fundamentally different than normal matter. Or maybe the observations and even the models are simply being misinterpreted somehow and there's a straightforward explanation for the discrepancy. Obviously, it's going to take some additional work to find out, but this is a really interesting result. Dark matter is clearly a thing, even though we don't yet fully know what it is. One thing we don't expect it to do is coalesce into really small things like planets and stars, because it doesn't seem to otherwise interact with anything, including itself. Our sun, for example, is not likely to have huge concentrations of dark matter clumped inside, but it does have enough mass to act as a strong gravitational lens on the scale of the solar system. That's why there's a plan to use the sun's gravitational lens to image the surface of exoplanets. I made a video about that, so feel free to check that out when we're done here. My thanks to my Patreon supporters for helping to keep Launchpad Astronomy going, and I'd like to welcome my newest patrons, Henry, Franchek Hervatasala, and Sergasi. I'd also like to thank Anna for her intergalactic level support, and Michael Dowling, Stephen J. Morgan, and Morrison Wild for their cosmological level support. If you'd like to support Launchpad for the price of a cup of coffee every month, well, please visit my Patreon page. And if you'd like to join me on this journey through this incredible universe of ours, well, please make sure you subscribe and ring that notification bell so that you don't miss out on any new videos. Until next time, stay home, stay healthy, and stay curious, my friends.